First of all, we need to understand what is government intervention. I hope all of you know what is government. Here the government refers to two. One is the home country. And the host country. Intervention means how the government intervene in the private business transaction. Intervene in private enterprise business transaction. As you learned in the last week class, government comes under the political risk. As we learned in the last week class, government comes under the political risk. So government can impose risk to the private enterprise business transaction. It can happen in the home country or host country and poses political risk. Government intervention through intervening in the private enterprise business transaction, either in the home country or host country, poses political risk. That's what we're going to learn today in the class. Here are some of the objectives of today's learning. The nature of government intervention, rationale, why the government intervene, the rationale, the instruments government use to intervene, what are the consequences of the intervention, how it evolved for the last decade, a few decades ago until today, and how it will evolve in the future, how the intervention changed during the global financial crisis, and how firms can respond to the government intervention. Okay, we try to do until maybe 4 for 1 hour and the rest another 1 hour after a break. First look at the government intervention. As I mentioned to you earlier, the government intervention can pose risk in terms of political risk. Governments intervene in the trade and investment of the private enterprise to achieve political, social and economic objectives. As you all know, government plays an important role to ensure the political stability, economic success, social stability, economic prosperity. So government intervene through a lot of instrument which we are going to look at it later. Government imposed trade and investment barrier that benefit interest groups such as the local interest groups, domestic firms, industries and labor unions. We should look at it later. Government intervention alters the competitive landscape by hindering or helping the ability firms to compete internationally. What does it mean? Alters the competitive landscape. Government intervene in the private enterprise can change or alter the competitive landscape of a company. How? Let's take Japan. And this is US. Japan export car. Export car to US. US impose tariff to Japan. Why? They want to protect. Why? To protect local car such as General Motors. Right? Is it good for local car, GM, when the US imposed tariff? When imposed tariff, what happened? Japan export car to US become less, isn't it? Right? Is it good for GM? Yes. But over there, I mentioned, it alter the competitive landscape of the local company. How? When you impose tariff, less car from Japan coming to US, yes, it's very beneficial for GM because there is no competitor or less competitor. What will happen when there is less competition? The productivity drops. There is no challenge, isn't it? There is no competition. In this class, do you compete with each other? Huh? Yes, isn't it? Who want to get first class, who want to get second class and so on, isn't it? If I don't give grading A, B, C, D, is there any motivation to do well in your studies?
Yes.
Without A, B, C, D, yeah? Then there's no competition. When there's no competition, A, B, C, D grading, your productivity will drop. Everyone will pass. Like happening in some university, yeah? Like in Lim Kok Wing, everyone can pass. Lim Kok Wing. Do you know where is Lim Kok Wing? But I'll be in trouble, lah, because this will be recorded now. And someone catch me. Hey, why you say Lim Kok Wing pass everyone? Yes. When there is no competition, everyone will pass. In USM, there is a grading. So, you will be more productive and you will strive for quality. You will strive for quality. So over here, the quality also drop. So in the long run, they will lose to Japan. That's why Toyota number one, GM bottom of the list. Now, do you know why Toyota is number one? Because of the continuous protection by the US government can alter, can change the competitive landscape of a company. I'll give you more examples later. So government intervention is an important dimension of country risk. So government intervene for many reasons. One of it is protectionism. National economic policies that restrict free trade, for example, like this. Let's take, we changed a little bit the scenario now. So over here, German export car to Malaysia. Quality car. Malaysia imposed tariff to German. Why? To protect? Protect what? Our local car Proton. What is happening to Proton now? Productivity drop, quality drop. At the end, they lose to? German, yeah. German. in the long run. In the long run. Why they are doing that? Protectionism. To protect. You see here? To protect. Protectionism. When you want to protect, then you will lose in the long run. Let's say I do not grade you A, B, C, D, E. I protect you. Let's pass everyone. But in the long run, none of you will get a job. A good job. You'll get a job, lah. But not a high salary job. You'll never get. Because all of you are not to the high quality that the industry expects. So what do we want now? Do we want this? Do you want to protect? Let's answer this question later when we have complete everything. Please answer the question. Do we need this protectionism or not? Do we need or do not need at all? So normally government has its protectionism, national economic policies that restrict free trade. Restrict free trade through tariff. Usually intended to raise revenue or protect domestic industries such as Proton Saga from foreign competition. For example, like from German, from US, from even India. Okay? Even India. India also produces car now. And for example, another one is also a customs, where the checkpoint at national port of entry where officials inspect imported goods and levy tariffs. So even at the customs, they can make the process very difficult for the car or any products come to the country. They may have a lot of red tape, a lot of checkpoint inspection, a lot of procedures, and a lot of rules that may be considered as a barrier for international trade. So these are some of the key instruments that we'll look at it today. For example, like number one, tariff. Tariff is basically a tax on import. A tax on import. That means if you buy a car for 100,000, an import tariff will cost the car to become 110,000. So the 10,000 is the tax. Let's say we buy the car from German, is RM 100K. After the tax, the price become tax, another 10K for example. So the price will become 110K. So this is what we call a tax, the tariff tax. The tariff here. Non-tariff trade barrier. So the government also can impose non-monetary barriers. We call it non-tariff trade barrier. For example, like quota. Quota means a quantitative restriction on import of a specific product. For example, like we limit the number of car coming to the country from Japan, for example. We limit a number of steel or textile entering US. I will show you some examples later. Investment barrier rules and laws that hinder foreign direct investment, for example, like Mexico's restriction in its oil industry. So the barriers in terms of rules, red tape, all this will be hindering the free trade. So there were two types. One is the tariff, another one is non-tariff, which we'll look at in more examples later. Let me show you another example of the tariff and how it has altered the competitiveness of an industry. Other than the car, another example here. And now you let me know. whether the steel industry in US a success or not a success. You let me know after I share with you this example. Just now, is it a success for GM? No, until now GM is suffering. Until now, General Motors is suffering because of the too much protection. Too much protection, no good. Okay. The US government during the President Bush imposed tariff on import of foreign steel to protect US steel manufacturer from foreign competition, aiming to give the US steel industry time to restructure and revive itself. Okay? This is the US steel industry. This is Japan. Okay? In fact, US buys steel a lot from Japan and also from China. So when they been imported by US, these local manufacturers cannot be successful. Why? Because the price are more competitive, more cheaper and high volume compared to the US own industry. So they cannot survive, though they have to decline. So US government thought, hey, we are not doing justice to the local industry, isn't it? We need to protect them again as what they have done to the GM. Let's protect them again. What happened? When tariff imposed to the steel industry, what will happen to the steel price? What happened? What will happen when US government imposed tariff on the import of steel to the steel price? What will happen? The steel price go up. When the steel price go up, the higher the cost for the steel, for the users of steel. Who use steel? Car industry again. Increased production costs for firms that use steel, such as Ford, Whirlpool. Whirlpool is the company that makes refrigerator, and General Electric also use steel in most of the electronic products, isn't it? So when the price of the steel goes up because of the tariff, what happened? The production cost goes up for GM, for Whirlpool that produce refrigerator, for electronic products, and also reduce prospects for selling products in the world market, making US steel firm less competitive. So what happened again? When the steel price goes up because of the tariff, everyone suffer, even the local companies suffer. So what happened to the US steel company at the end? What happened? Lower productivity. Why lower productivity? Because too much pampered. Too much protectionism. When people or government protect you or the company, they may not be innovative to improve the productivity. So the productivity will drop compared to the foreign company. They are productive. That's why they are exporting to you. This company do not innovate. Price increase because productivity drop, quality drop, end up the business can slow down in the whole country, in the domestic country. That's why the steel tariff were removed within 2 years. You see another? So earlier US want to protect the local steel maker, but end up what? Price goes up, cost went up, local producers can't cope up with the cost and the business slowdowns and the quality drop of the local steel maker, and the end the government itself removed the tariff within 2 years. Now you tell me, does the tariff really protect the domestic industry? Not really. Maybe short term. Long term may not be, the case. So it is important for you or for the government not to impose any tariff. So we advocate free trade again. We advocate free trade. This is good for everyone. You, me, everyone. The global citizens. Huh? Another example, which I had to explain to you earlier, the car industry. I will repeat again so that you really capture what I mentioned. Huh? Now you tell me again whether the car industry in the US really improved or not, really protected or not. In the 1980s, the US government imposed voluntary export restraint, quota, on imports of cars from Japan to insulate the US auto industry. What happened? Result one, Detroit. Detroit is the biggest car making territory in the US. For example, like in Malaysia, the car making, where's the car making city in Malaysia? Where Proton been made? Eh? Tanjung? Tanjung Malim, Proton City. So in US, Detroit is the similar to Proton City. In Detroit, automakers had less of an incentive to improve quality, design and overall production appeal. When you protect someone, or when protect the car, when you protect an industry, they will not be innovative to improve the design. That's why General Motors, the design of the car is so lousy. So lousy. Detroit's ability to compete in the global auto industry weakened. That's why number one car in the world is Toyota. Because of the mistakes done by the US government to protect. In Japan, nobody protects them. That's why the car industry in Japan very innovative, isn't it? Such as Nissan. Number one is Toyota. Number two is Honda. Number three, Nissan. Nissan is number six, you know. But last day they went to number three. Why? What is the latest Nissan model? Huh? When you got free time, go to the Nissan showroom. You got free time or not? No free time, Semester break? Semester don't go home. Go to the showroom or visit some company to collect your data for your assignment. Okay. Go to Nissan showroom. What are the name of the new cars in the Nissan brand? Nissan Selfie. Huh? Nissan? Huh? Almera. Oh, all the names are so sweet to mention, isn't it? Almera, Selfie, another one? I can't remember. Why the names are so sweet? What was the name before? Nissan Sunny. Not so nice, isn't it? Nissan Selfie is more nicer to mention. Why? Because of the innovation in the Japan. And furthermore, the joint venture Nissan with a French company. That's why the names are very Spanish, French sound. Okay? There's one case study, we'll look at it in the future. Now you tell me, do they really protect the US auto industry? Short term, maybe. Long term, no. Okay? So protectionism may not be a worthwhile effort by a government to intervene in the business of private enterprise. Okay? That's why we are advocating free trade. No intervention by the government. Consequences of the protectionism, what has really happened? Let's look at it. And you tell me whether it's true or not. Number one, reduce supply of goods to buyers. When you increase the price through tariff, people will not buy, and the less import or export will take over or take place. So reduce supply of goods and to buyers, price inflation, true or not? Reduce variety, fewer choices available to buyers. Okay, what car will you buy after you graduate? What car do you buy when you graduate? I'll come back to you. What car will you buy after you graduate? Honda. What car will you buy after you graduate? Can I hear you? Volkswagen. What car will you buy? Suzuki. What car will you buy? Nobody mentioned about local car. Nobody bought local car. 10 years ago, when I asked my student here, they said, I will buy Proton Saga, I will buy Kanchel, I will buy all the those days model, like Canary, then Vajra, Proton, Veera, Iswara, then Satriya. But now you have more choices. Reduce variety, fewer choices to buyers in the past. Why now a lot of choices? Because of the free trade through AFTA. I'll cover it in the next chapter actually. Free trade through AFTA, Asia Free Trade Agreement, where we allow more car come to Malaysia. That's why you have more choices. Let's say we remove this, then you have reduced variety and fewer choices available to buyers like you. Okay? Reduce competitiveness and various adverse unintended consequences to the home country and also the host country. Not good for everyone actually. For both home and host, not good. Okay, general rationale for government intervention. So I'm going to come to the government perspective. Why I'm as a government wanted to impose tariff, intervene in the private enterprise. Why I as a government? Why? What is my rationale? Here is some of the rationale. Number one, tariff can generate revenue for the government. Huge, you know? Like government of Kenya, 25% of the revenue come from tariff, Kenya. Okay? Malaysia, I think 15 to 20% come from tariff. So it's revenue for the government. Singapore, I think is above 50% of the revenue come from tariff, because they import a lot and export a lot also as an entreport. Okay? Helps ensure the safety, security and welfare of the citizen. Okay? For example, most countries have basic regulation to protect the national food supply. You have to put some protectionism. For example, like in Malaysia, we have to protect the rice field, so that the rice farmers can continue to produce rice for our country. If you don't have protectionism for them, then we have to import a lot of rice. So we have to protect them for continuous supply of food. Helps government pursue broad economic, political and social objective for the nation. For example, if you support the local car, what happened? More employment, isn't it? More employment, what happened? More job opportunities for the locals, and more tax for the employees that working in the local company, and it's a revenue for the government again, and the income of the citizens will increase, and the quality of life of the local will increase. Can serve as the interest of the nation's firms and industry. For example, like our local firms, we want to protect the local firms interest for the long term. Okay, here some of the defensive rationale for the government intervention. Defensive means why we want to protect with some justification. Number one, protection of the national economy. Weak or young economy sometimes need protection from the foreign competitors. For example, like India is a very is a fast moving country. We can call emerging country, under the BRIC. B stands for Brazil. R for Russia. I for India. C for China. I'll ask this tomorrow in exam. What does it mean? Brazil, Russia, India, China. So this we call emerging economy. Emerging economy. So government of these countries have to protect the local because they are emerging. Can they fight with the developing nations? Quite difficult. Okay? Quite difficult. Can we compare our car with the, let's say, our Proton car? Can we compare with, let's say, Volkswagen? Can we? Can we compare? We can't. Because Volkswagen is from a developed nation, where people are very advanced in knowledge and technology. We are a developing nation. Can we compare? We can't. So we have to protect the national economy from the strongest one in the world. For example, India imposed barriers to shield its huge agricultural sector, which employ millions. India is an emerging economy, and the number one industry in the India is agriculture. So they have to protect the agriculture industry from competition. That's why they impose high tariff for import of rice, for example, because they want to protect the local farmers who do rice farming. They want to protect. They want to protect the local fruit farmers, for example, because number one industry in India is agriculture. We have to protect them. If not, they have no jobs. Okay? Protection of infant industry. Infant industry means young industry. Infant. Infant means baby lah. You know baby? Baby you have to protect, isn't it? Baby become teenager, teenager become an adult. Are you a teenager or adult? Teenager, no, you are 20s above, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you're no more a teenager anymore. You are an adult. So do we need to protect you?
Yes.
No need. Infant, you have to protect. Teenager, yes. Adult, no need. So when the industry as an infant stage, for example, like Proton Saga, we are moving from infant to a teenager, you have to protect Proton Saga. After 20 years, I think Proton Saga was established in 1984-85. The first car, 1980-83. So now it's what year? 2013. How many years? How many years? Calculate. 20 years. So we're still protecting. It's already adult age already. That is a problem. That's why Proton cannot become successful, because we still continue to protect. You are already adult. Can we still continue to protect you?
Yes.
We shouldn't. You should be thinking maturely, become independent, more self-reliant. So we should not continue to protect after 20 years, because it's already adulthood. Same goes to the industry. Now proton is 30 years, we should not protect anymore. So a young industry may need protection. For example, like Japan, long protected its car industry, but now no more. Japan is go for full freedom. National security. The US prohibits export of plutonium and similar product to North Korea. Why? Because of national security. We impose tariff to certain country so that they will not misuse certain activity for world disaster. For example, US government prohibit export of plutonium and similar product to North Korea. Why? Because plutonium can be used to create atomic bomb. So US government impose tariff or say no to export of plutonium to any country to North Korea. So we need to have government intervention. We need to protect the national economy, to protect the infant industry, to protect the national security, and the last not the least is national culture and identity. We need to protect our culture. Can we protect or not? This is what dress? It's a Western dress. Why I never wear my dhoti or whatever, my cultural costume? Why? Because I'm being influenced by the global culture. Isn't it? You go to Japan, what they wear? Huh? You go to China, what they wear? They also been influenced already, actually. So we want to protect the local culture. For example, you see here, Canada restrict foreign investment in its movie and TV industry because they want to protect the national culture of Canada. No investment in the TV or media. In France, we cannot invest in the telecommunication industry at all. We have a total barrier. Why? They want to protect the national culture and the identity. We cannot. Can you invest in the English Premier League clubs? Can you? EPL, can? Now can. Even our AirAsia boss have bought over Queen's Park. Now, because of the trade. Before we can't, because we want to protect the identity of the English Premier League. It's owned by who? United Kingdom. We want to protect the culture. But now, because of the free trade, we allow them to invest in those clubs. Foreigners can invest now. Okay, but the identity they still maintain, but they open up a little bit because of the free trade. Before, no. Okay, can you invest in the US basketball clubs? Still cannot. You can't. Because it's the identity of the US for the basketball clubs. We cannot invest in those clubs. Okay? So these are some of the protection by the government to say no, don't compete. We will put some restriction because to protect all these interests. Okay? Offensive rationale for government intervention. We have defensive to say why we want to protect. Offensive here means in a good way, we want to say that why we are protecting. Over here is defensive to say no. Okay? Over here we say why. You know, why we want to protect. For example, national strategic priorities. We want to protect some of the national strategic priorities in the country. For example, countries create better protection helps ensure the development of the industry that bolsters the national economy. For example, India protects the IT industry because IT industry is a growing industry in India, and it's bring a lot of revenue to the India country. So they want to protect the IT industry. Japan used to protect the automotive because it is an emerging industry and it brings a lot of revenue to the country, but now no more. Okay? So it's a national strategic priority where some of the industries are very, very important in terms of revenue. So they have to continue to protect to certain years, maybe 20 years. After that, they let it go. Increase employment. Okay, we need to continue to protect our economy so that we can increase our employment in the global market. Okay, here are some of the types and effects of the government intervention. Can you see? Here's intervention type, some of the definition, what are the effect on customers, firm and government, and what are the contemporary examples, what are the examples which we can show you. So we have covered so far, what is tariff, what is non-tariff, and more examples going to be followed now. And we have talked about the defensive and offensive perspective of the intervention. Why we protect? Why? In a good way and also in another good way. Another one is on the defensive where we say no. Offensive means yes, we protect for a good reason. That is what offensive means. So now we go to the examples of the tariff and non-tariffs. Okay? And what are the impacts and what are the examples we can show you? Ready? Maybe in your slide it's a bit smaller. You can't see the fonts. Maybe for this particular slides, for the next 1, 2, 3, you have to print in one page each. Okay? Or you can refer to your textbook. Nah? Okay? Let's continue. First is tariff, it's a tax. Example, Switzerland charges a tariff of 44% on agricultural product import. Example, they put 44%, you know, on agricultural product. Why? They want to protect the Switzerland agriculture. Switzerland famous for what? Chocolate, watch. So they protect the watch industry by saying no to any investor. Quota. Quota means what? A quantitative restriction. That means you only can import 10 tons only or 20 tons only, 40 tons of palm oil for example, 10 tons of rubber. That's all. That's the limit. So Brazil has imposed a quota on the number of foreign firms that can be imported for theatrical screening and home video distribution because they want to protect their local culture in Brazil. Local content requirements, for example, they want to ensure there is a local content from the local suppliers. For example, like AFTA, it says that we need to have a local content in our car that we are importing. For example, we buy Peugeot, 60% is from France where the car comes from, another 40% is from the local content from NASA Kia, from NASA Motors. Okay? Local content. And regulations on technical standards, for example, safety, health and regulation, very strict regulations. For example, Saudi Arabia banned importation of firearms. Okay? The European Union requires extensive testing on thousands of different imported chemicals. Yes, European Union is one of the trading blocs that have a stringent requirement for all the chemical products that have been imported to their country. Malaysia, no. Okay? For example, recently, I think 6 or 8 months ago, maybe a year, we have some products coming to our country, food, for example, contaminated with toxic. Example is instant noodles. Right, instant noodles. Do you eat instant noodle? Don't eat. Because the flavor thing, it has some chemical which can make you addicted to eat the instant noodles. Right. And they have a high level of preservative. And this product cannot go to European Union because of high standards of testing. Can come to our country lah, because we don't really check so much. Because our country say, no problem, let's eat. Let's eat. Don't worry, let's eat. European Union, no. Can you tell me some of the product that you use cause some problem to you? Do you have any experience? For example, you take the cream, apply on your skin, suddenly become black. Happens to you or not? Huh? Never happened to you. Then you apply on your face. Suddenly your face that is very smooth become like a moon. Happens or not? Never happened. This is what we call product that never go through a stringent check. You never go, happen all this to you? Then you drink mineral water, suddenly you got stomach ache. Got or not? No. Never. Never happened to you. I experienced all this, you know. The other day I bought one mineral water, I drink, then I got a stomach ache. Then I thought maybe my stomach got problem, then my daughter drink, my daughter also got stomach ache. Then I thought maybe my wife will be safe, and she drinks, she also got stomach ache. So that shows our product do not go through some stringent tests. European Union, very strict. Very, very strict. Okay? Administrative and bureaucratic procedures. Sometimes they have a lot of procedures, red tape. As a barrier, for example, Russia imposes a series of inspection and bureaucratic procedure for the import of alcoholic beverages. That means you have to have a lot of declaration, you have to have fill a lot of forms for you to buy the product. FDI and ownership restriction, that means you cannot go for greenfield. FDI means foreign direct investment. You cannot go direct. There are a lot of restriction. You cannot go for greenfield. For example, Switzerland again requires foreign firm seeking to sell insurance there to do so by establishing a local subsidiary. You cannot go 100% equity owned. Must have a subsidiary there. And Brazil restricts foreign investment in its media industry again. Okay, and also transportation. For example, like Turkey grants an export subsidy up to 20% for the local producer of wheat and sugar. Why? They want to give subsidy for the local firm by 20%. That means 20% cheaper so that they can become competitive in the global market. Countervailing duty. Countervailing duty means increased duty imposed on a product to offset subsidy by another country. That means if Malaysia gives 20% subsidy, the another country that we are exporting, they will give tax 20%. So 2020 net is zero. We call this countervailing duty. For example, like India imposes countervailing duty on the import of numerous products so that the net is zero. That means as though there is no intervention at all. Anti-dumping duty. Anti-dumping means what? That means we would don't want a country to go and dump a product in one country to reduce the price. Keep on dumping. That means, for example, like now in Malaysia, China is keep on dumping the textile in Malaysia. Clothes, children clothes, adult clothes, China is keep on dumping to Malaysia. That's why local companies have to close shop, you know. Most of the textile company in Malaysia are closing shops. If you do this in US, they impose you anti-dumping tax. Malaysia have not imposed yet. Okay, that's why some of the clothes that you buy is very cheap. It's very cheap, huh? Especially in the night market or supermarket, because of the China dump. So it's not really a dump, but it's giving effect to the local producers of textile. So it's almost like a dumping, actually. For example, like the United States has imposed anti-dumping duties on the import of low-cost steel in order to support the US-based steel manufacturers. So in US, they will impose this anti-dumping duty. Malaysia, we do not do this. You see here, average tariff over the time has really reduced. The advanced economy and the developing economy, why? Because we want to advocate free trade. That's why you can buy Honda, Volkswagen after you graduate, Yeah, better buy all these cars because it's a good cars. Yeah. Relationship between tariff, world GDP and the volume of world trade. You see here, average tariff drop, the world GDP goes up. World export also goes up. When the world export goes up, the world GDP will go up, and as a result of the drop of tariff. If tariff goes up, everything will start to drop. Okay, tariffs are widespread. What we are trying to say here is, tariff really helped the government to collect revenue. Example, in developing economies, tariffs are very common. In advanced economy, tariffs still provide significant revenue. For example, in a given year, US collects more tariff revenue on shoes other than cars. For example, $1.63 billion on shoes. European Union applied tariff up to 215% on meat, 116% on cereals, and 70% on tennis shoes. So the tariff really makes revenue for the country. But what I'm trying to say is the tariff is keep on declining because of the GATT and the WTO. GATT means General Agreement on Tariff and Trade, which was signed many, many years ago to make sure countries committed to drop or reduce the tariff progressively. Okay? GATT is an agreement where nation commits to reduce tariff progressively. Of course, we cannot drop within a day, within 10 months or a year. We want to reduce progressively. And after GATT, WTO takes over, World Trade Organization. Same thing, they also make the nations commit to reduce tax progressively, World Trade Organizations. For example, like NAFTA, Mexico eliminated nearly all tariff on import from the US but maintained tariff with the rest of the world. We will learn this in the trading blocks. NAFTA, we will learn this. China reduced its tariff since joining WTO in 2001. You see here, when the countries commit to reduce tariff progressively, when China become a member of WTO, they also start to reduce the tariff. Okay, subsidies are, as I mentioned to you earlier, it is a government assistance in terms of monetary or even other resources. For example, provide the seeds for the farming, provide the fertility for the farming, or maybe monetary incentives to help the industry. Okay, which just now already looked at it. Now it's a proper definition I want to show you. Example, in China, Shanghai Automotive and numerous other MNEs are partly owned by the Chinese government. Okay, and receive huge financial resources. Europe and US provide huge agriculture subsidy to farmers. For example, EU subsidies represent 40% of the EU budget. Okay, here are some of the farm subsidies in the European Union in terms of how France, Spain, Germany, Italy give subsidy. So subsidy is not only in the developing nation, also in the developed nation. On certain sectors, for example, agriculture. Mostly on farms. Industry like electronics, automobile, we may not need so much subsidy. Why we need subsidy for the farming, for example? Because of the catastrophe. Normally given to the farming or agriculture because of the natural disaster. Industry such as electronic, we may not give so much subsidy. We have other forms of intervention like tariff and so on. So we come to the economic freedom. So we want to ensure countries go towards free trade so that the activities such as import, export are purely based on comparative advantage. So, in the economic freedom, what we want to achieve is, at the end, we want to achieve free trade, and the trade should be based on comparative advantage, not based on intervention by the government, which can poses the political risk. That's what happened in this area. We don't want this to happen. We want to achieve free trade through comparative advantage. We import, export based on comparative advantage, not through government intervention, which can pose political risk, and in the long term, the companies suffer. That's what we can see in the Malaysia, US, in the automobile industry, steel industry. We don't want that to happen. We want to achieve economic freedom, that the import-export are purely based on comparative advantage, not based on government intervention. Okay, over here maybe you can see at the world map what are the countries that are really providing the level of economic freedom. The one you can see in this color, such as this country, over here, Australia, over here, are really giving a lot of economic freedom in terms of percentage. In the textbook, you can refer to page. What page? 268, 269, where you can see the economic. Sorry. Two five zero. You can see the level of economic freedom 80 to 100%. For example, like here in these countries. Then 70 to 79% in this color region. For example, like United States, over here, 70 to 79% freedom. Then in the yellow, 60 to 69%. For example, like here, most of the European nations over here. Then in the green, 50 to 59%, most part of the China, India, Cambodia, Brazil are in the range of 50 to 59%, and the rest are even lower than 59%. Okay, so as an entrepreneur, US entrepreneur, you want to see this world map, and which country you want to go? You want to go to the country, maybe on the top three, out of the top two, where it gives you full freedom, where you're not being taxed, you don't have to have a quota to meet, you don't have to go through administration barrier, you don't have to go through a lot of strict regulation. Okay, so you want to, that's why many people, even Malaysians, have set up business in Australia. Many Malaysians have gone to Canada to set up business, because this provide a lot of freedom for them to invest, to sell their product, to sell their ideas and become successful with the full freedom, and only we go through comparative advantage. That means you are good at certain things, go and show to the global market. Alright, that's very important. So basically based on comparative advantage, where is your strength, and based on your strength you capture the world market. So these countries provide that avenue, and also US, and also those in the green, in the yellow, green maybe in the fourth level, and the rest are even lower than the fourth level. Okay, the one in this color region. Malaysia, where? What color region, Malaysia? Malaysia is yellow, not too bad. It is in the third region. That's why I'm trying to say, Malaysia is another emerging economy. A lot of FDI coming to Malaysia, because Malaysia provides a very good investment climate. As you can see in the third region, the yellow color, provide a lot of very good investment climate. Compared to these countries here, compared to here actually, we are very comparable to the yellow region and the European Union countries over here, and also at the Latin America. Import substitution versus export-led development. What does it mean to you? Import substitution means what? A policy restrict import in order to protect home country firms. Okay, it's still go to the protection. Another one is export-led development in Singapore, Hong Kong, Taiwan, South Korea, where these countries are really export intensive. So we have two type of countries. One is restrict import, another one is export intensive. Okay, so which one you want to choose in terms of your economic freedom? Evolution. What is evolution? You know, have you heard about Great Depression? Great Depression means where the whole nation, especially from UK, they have gone through a recession. We call it Great Depression. When they have a great fire, the whole London burned. Do you know? No. The whole London burned. We call it a great fire. That's where it started, the Great Depression. So the world gone through this. After the Great Depression, the world trying to introduce the GATT over here, where it promotes less tariff. Why they want to promote that? Because they want to come out from the depression. In order for you to come out from the depression, you have to be freedom, right? When you become more freedom, a lot of activities take place in the economy, and the economy already out from the Great Depression. It's what I'm trying to say here. The role of GATT, the role of GATT is very simple. GATT is the first one, now it's already renamed to WTO. Okay? So WTO started in 1995, where they rename it. GATT become renamed to WTO. And very simple, the philosophy. The philosophy is what? Progressively reduce the tariff. Let's look at China. China, that is a very good example, you know, how their closed economy become a economic freedom. oriented country, and that makes China progress very fast. In 1980s, China liberalized its economy, and now China is number one economic giant. Number one. Number two, US. Number three, Japan. Used to be number one US, now US is number two. China is number one. So if you cannot get a job in Malaysia, don't be sad. Go to China. I got a few friends in China. Here they earn 5,000. There they go, they earn 20,000. Yeah. Here they earn 20,000. They go there, they earn 50,000. Few friends of mine. Very good. Okay, very good. Why? Economic freedom. India also has liberalized its economy. In 1990s, market opened to foreign trade and investment, and enterprises were privatized, and protectionism has declined, but high tariffs still averaging 20% and FDI limitations still there, but they have really broken the closeness of the economy. So all this happened in 1990s, you know, you see here China also, 1980s, the first, then India, then Malaysia, and so on, it continued to grow. Intervention of the global financial crisis, so when this happened, 80s China opened, then India 1990s, what happened next? Global financial crisis. Okay. When that happened, what really take place? This become vice versa. When the economic crisis happened, government start to put out of impose of government intervention. Earlier they take out, isn't it? When the crisis happened, they put back all the intervention to protect the economy again. I repeat again, Depression, after depression, they take out a lot of intervention. So they come out from the depression. Economy started to open like China, India. When the crisis of economy take place, they put back all the tariff and non-tariff. So this is evolution. Okay, it's evolution. And these are some of the examples. For example, how the government put back. For example, like US government, increase its power on Treasury Department, the European Union increased the multinational bank financial institution, some government increased protectionism, Russia raised tariff, and so on. And how the firm should react? How firm should react to the government intervention? Depression, after depression, we take out all the tariff and non-tariff. China, India open. When the economic crisis take place, all we put back. That's why you can see just now. And how you as a firm, you as an entrepreneur, going to react to this? Very simple. You as an entrepreneur understand the world map. Where still companies or countries still have freedom. Choose the most appropriate entry strategy. Maybe you want to use licensing. You want to use a direct FDI, maybe you want to use JV, okay? Maybe you want to take advantage of the foreign trade zones. I mean, foreign trade zones are no tax at all. We call FTZs. Example like Mexico. Seek favorable custom classification for exported products. That means you look at the some of the customs are really good. For example, like in Singapore, the custom service are very good. Where they have less regulation, you can go to Singapore. Example, government Hong Kong put so much cash to build Hong Kong Disney Park. Mercedes-Benz received several hundred billion dollars in subsidy to build the US state in Alabama. In German, go to US. Hong Kong Disneyland from US come to Hong Kong. How? See, they look at some of the benefit and they go to the country to do the investment. And lobby for freer trade and investment. Done. Okay, let me summarize what we learned today. We learn about government intervention. How the government intervention poses political risk and how the political risk makes the country less competitive. Then we learn about the instrument of tariff. We learn instrument about non-tariff, which is quota, regulation, inspection, custom regulation, quota and so on. Then we learn about the evolution, depression, GATT, WTO. Then we talk about economic crisis where we all put back the intervention and how the firm should react to it by doing homework, looking at the which country still have economic freedom, invest in those countries using JV or FDI, which we'll learn in the next class. Okay? And also taking advantage of some of the subsidies and benefit provided by the government. Example, Johor Iskandar is a government giving opportunity for foreigners to invest. So it's a government help. So we need to take advantage of those incentives given by the government now at this time, economic crisis. Okay? That's a very good example, Johor Iskandar project.